Good afternoon, everybody, and welcome. On behalf of Regina, thanks to everybody for coming, and I'm Eddie Trunk here to kind of MC things this afternoon as we remember and celebrate our dear friend Frankie Banali. And, you know, seeing all these photos we've had a chance to look at on the screen here behind us, it reminds me, in every one of them, you see Frankie pretty much giving everybody big hugs. And that's what I think of so much with Frankie. And even though it's been over a year since we lost him, I think we can still feel those big hugs in this room right now. And these things are incredibly difficult to do. As I was telling Regina and some of the people last night, I've had a chance to do this a few times for some artists that were friends, and it's never easy. And you try so hard to prepare stuff and write stuff down, and I end up just throwing it in the trash and just riffing and going with it, and that's all you can really do. And as much as these things suck, when they do, it is great to pull everybody together and share memories of these great people that we love so much and see each other like we did last night at the Rainbow, many of us, and gather and share stories and memories, and then obviously have an event like this to come together as well and celebrate the lives of these great friends of ours that we lost. For me, and there's going to be a series of speakers that are going to come up here throughout the afternoon and share some stories, but for me personally, I want to thank Regina for the honor of asking me to do this. It really does mean a lot to me, and I'm grateful for the opportunity to do it and to be here. Quiet Riot, for me, was an incredibly important band in my career in radio and TV, because it's really one of the bands that started things for me, because as a kid in 1983, right out of high school, I heard Mental Health, and I immediately was gravitated to it, and I was working at a record store at the time, and we were selling it in box lots. I mean, we couldn't keep it on the shelves at the time. But this was before the record really broke wide open, and my local radio station in New Jersey, I would always get on the owners of that radio station and be like, you gotta be playing this stuff, and you gotta do a metal show, and they're like, well, yeah, none of that stuff really sells. At that time, there really wasn't anything called a metal show on radio. And I said, what about this? And, you know, there was Mental Health selling a tremendous amount of records. I said, this band would be great to be able to do something with, and they're selling records. And really, that record, along with a few others, was the catalyst for helping me get my first ever radio show. And interestingly, it wasn't long after that I met Quiet Riot and had them on that show as a 18-year-old kid, and one of the first interviews I ever did, and having a chance to see them very early on. Actually, last night at the Rainbow, I met John Vazalou, who you'll be hearing from, and John was the tour manager. He came up to me and said, I remember when you were a kid in New Jersey, and we were coming around to see you. And, you know, it's amazing memories. And it dawned on me, too, because when you think of Frankie as the player, I mean, just such an incredible, thunderous drummer. It's such a signature sound. And you think about this, three of Quiet Riot's biggest hits start with Frankie, whether it's Mental Health or Come On, Feel the Noise, or one of my favorites I used to always talk to him about, The Wild and the Young, that drum beat in that song and the way it opens. So Frankie's sound so thunderous and identifiable all the time, and that was something that really impacted me as a kid as well. So having that early history with the band and with Frankie was super important to me personally and to my career. And we kept that, Frankie and I and many of the other guys in Quiet Riot, we kept that friendship. And as my career grew and they went through all their changes and ups and downs, we always stayed in touch and did countless interviews and had countless great moments. And, you know, one of my great regrets when it comes to Frankie for me is every time I would see him, early on, he found out that I was half Italian. And, you know, my mom is 100%. And I literally grew up in an Italian liquor deli store. And of course, I'm an East Coast guy, Frankie, New York City. So it was immediately like, yo, you gotta come over. I gotta cook you macaroni. We gotta have pasta, you know. And one of my great regrets is I never had a chance to do that. He offered so many times, come to the house, let me cook for you. And I never had a chance to do it just simply because I never, you know, I don't live here. So every time I've ever come here, it's get in and do what I have to do and get out. So I never had that downtime with him. It was always seeing him on the road and at a gig or hanging out in a dressing room or cruise ship or wherever we were at whatever given time. But it was always that, I always looked so forward to seeing him because it was always that warm embrace and friendship and like, my brother, you know. And that meant so much to me. And there's a lot of people with a lot of things to say throughout the course of the day that we're going to hear from, and I'll be bringing them on and off as we go. But one final thing I want to say before we get our first speaker here is, of all the things that Frankie did and all of the music he gave us, whether it was A Quiet Riot or some of the great things he did that some people may not even know outside of Quiet Riot, one of the most impressive things to me was how he conducted himself in the final year or two of his life. It was stunning how brave he was and his disposition and still being the same old Frankie, at least to me, right to the very end. And I interviewed Frankie 3 times during his illness. And one time, I recall I was doing my show from the Sirius XM studio here in LA, and he came in directly from a treatment. And I remember talking to him and I said, you feel up to coming in and coming into the building? Because he had said, I'm going for a treatment in the morning, and he was, you know, getting the chemo. I said, are you sure you want to come in? He goes, no, I want to come in. I want to be there. And he was still playing right up till as much as he could till the end. And he came in that day, this is very long ago, maybe 2 years ago at this point, and he walked in and he came into the studio and he put a big bag on the console. And he goes, those are for you, take them home, give them to your kids. I said, what is it? And I dumped the bag open and they were Kit Kat bars. And I said, what are you giving me Kit Kats for? And he goes, look at them. And I looked and they were all these weird flavors I had never heard of, like green tea Kit Kats or something. Like, what? I never saw these. He goes, that's the whole point. I go, well, where are they? He goes, they're from Japan. I said, oh, he goes, yeah, they got different kinds of, it's crazy, they got different kinds of Kit Kats in Japan. I said, oh, okay. He goes, take them home to your kids or whatever. I said, how old are these? When did you go get them in Japan? He goes, I was there last week. And this is a guy that was, you know, really going through a lot. He said, you went to Japan last week? And he said, yeah. He said, what'd you do? He goes, oh, I went and played with a Zeppelin show there. So it was stunning to me that with all he was going through, he was still playing right till the very end for as long as he could. And here he is, you know, a really tough part of his treatments, and he was thinking of other people. And he was coming and bringing me candy for my kids and what have you, and I took the candy home, and it lasted about 30 seconds before my kids rifled through all of it and ate it. And, you know, they asked me, Dad, where'd this come from? And I said, Japan. And I told them the story, and they were amazed as well. So I'm sure you're going to be hearing a lot of different stories about Frankie and the person he was and the things that he loved and how he connected and touched all of us. But those are just a few thoughts from me to get things started. And I know we have a lot of other people, whether they be friends, family, bandmates, past or present, whatever the case may be, that will share some thoughts. And then at the end, we're going to offer everybody to come up and pay their respects. Frankie's with us right there at the moment on his drum stool, where he certainly would love to be. So you are welcome at the end to come by. Photos are welcome also. And then when that's completed and we're all done, then we'll gather outside and we will be able to visit where his final spot will be here. So everybody can know, if you want to come visit down the line as well, where he'll be interned. So I'd like to get things started as far as our speakers are concerned by bringing up Neil Citron. Neil is a recording and mixing engineer, worked with Frankie for many years. They did a lot of recording and writing together. So Neil is our first speaker, and we welcome him to the stage now.
Thank you. I met Frankie late in life. I met him 2003. I was running a studio in Hollywood, and he was looking for a place to record the drums for Frankie Banali and Friends, the tribute to Led Zeppelin record he did. We started recording it in 2004 late, in 2005, and he had certain people, Steve Fisher played some guitar on it, Tony Franklin played bass on it. In fact, Tony introduced me to Frankie. And after Frankie came and recorded the drums, we became really good friends. And the recurring theme you're gonna hear about from everybody today is, if Frankie liked you, he liked you. If he loved you, he smothered you. He shared his friendship and his love with me, two greatest gifts he could have ever given me. I recorded the drums for rehab. Frankie had a 103 fever. And he would play one song, go in the bathroom, throw up, come back. Play the next song, go to the bathroom, throw up. We kept saying, you sure you're okay? No, I'm fine, just as Eddie said. He had his mindset, you could not stop him. Howard Lee said it best, he was a force to reckon with. And he really was. I did a lot of writing with him. And the thing about him that maybe people don't know is that he could have been a music historian. He knew so much about so many people. And if you say to him, what snare drum did you play on Metal Health? Oh, that was his Ludwig, and I bought it here, and I paid it. He had the greatest memory ever. I wish I had it, but I don't. I enjoyed, he didn't make matakot for me and my parents one night when we were at the studio. He was a great chef, really good cook, really enjoyed it. He gave me this shirt, that's why I'm wearing it. He bought a bathrobe for my mother on her birthday. I mean, this is Frankie. He never missed a chance to be the great guy that he was. If he found out that you needed a favor and you didn't ask him, he was pissed. So that's the kind of guy he was. You'll hear people knew him a lot longer than me, but all I can say is that from the day I met him, he was like a brother, and I will miss him forever and ever and ever, and peace and love.
Thank you, Neil. Next up, we have a great friend, old friend as well, and best known for his work with LA Guns, which he still is a member of Riley's LA Guns, and also played in Wasp, which of course, Frankie also played in Wasp at one point in his career as well. Please welcome from LA Guns, Steve Riley, to the stage.
Hi, welcome to everybody, and glad you had the time to make it here to honor our old friend Frankie. You know, I knew Frankie since 1977. I moved out here in 77, and we were part of a bunch of guys that hung out at the Rainbow, just waiting to get our turn, and there was a bunch of us. There was me and Frankie, there was Blackie Lawless, there was Nikki Six, there was Stephen Piercy. None of us were signed to any deals, and we were just waiting for our turn, you know, to join the big club. And we were a bunch of guys hanging out at the Bow every single night, and that's when I got to meet Frankie. We became really good friends, and we were similar drummers. We had the same influences, John Bonham, Cozy Powell. And the next year, Frankie, you know, we were all broke. We had no money. We were just existing. And we had no money. We were in bands, but they weren't making any money. And the next year, Frankie joined Steppenwolf because it was a moneymaker. He could make some money doing it. And when he left Steppenwolf, there was a couple of versions of Steppenwolf at that time, too, and he was with the one with Nick St. Nicholas and Goldie McJohn. And when he left that, I replaced him in Steppenwolf. And I did that for a couple of years because I was broke, too, and I needed the money, and it was a good way to make money. And I did that for a couple of years, and then, you know, I hadn't seen Frankie for a couple of years after that. We were both trying to do things, you know, after I got out of Steppenwolf. He was mixed up with Michael Monarch, who was the original guitar player from Steppenwolf, and he was playing in a power trio, Monarch, and I went to see him at the Starwood, and the guy was a powerhouse. I stood on the side of the stage watching him, and I was just amazed how good he was. And, you know, the next thing I know is I'm up in Portland playing with a band, and MTV is breaking, and I see Quiet Riot. And I was like, wow, I know those guys. I knew Kevin, and I knew Frankie. And I was like, you know, they were just breaking the door open. It was like, you know, there really wasn't any metal scene. I know Van Halen came out in 77, but Quiet Riot was the band that busted it open for all of us. When they got signed and they had that album out and it did so well, it just opened the door for all of us to get signed. People were noticing how much good music all these young cats were making in LA, and a bunch of us got signed. Rat, Motley, Wasp, you know, Dawkins, Great White, tons of bands, and Quiet Riot was the key. They were the ones that busted that door wide open. And, you know, the thing is that, you know, he just kept pushing and pushing, and all of us did. And the next thing I know, you know, Quiet Riot is so big, I'm in Wasp, and we're on tour together. And it was just amazing because we had started from nothing, and here we are in a big arena with Quiet Riot headlining and Wasp opening up, and it was just an amazing thing, you know. And we had made it that far. And then when I was out of Wasp, he replaced me in Wasp. So we had this crisscross thing going on where I replaced him in a band, he replaced me in a band, and it just brought us closer, you know. We were just really, really good friends. We weren't the type of friends that hung out every night together, but we were really good friends. We knew it. We had this bond. And when we saw each other, it was really, really a strong thing. And I loved the guy, and he was just a killer drummer. And, you know, when he got sick, he played through that. I was amazed. I couldn't believe it. Anybody else, they would have sat it out and just taken care of themselves. And I know he took care of himself and went through all of his treatments and everything. But to play drums, I don't know if people realize how athletic it is. You're an athlete, you know, more than any other guy on stage. That drum thing that we're doing is athletic, and it takes a lot of strength to do it. And for him to do that when he was sick, it just showed me how much he loved the drums, how much he loved playing, being around his bandmates and playing for the fans and meeting the fans. And just, I couldn't believe it, you know, that he played through that. And, you know, I tell you what, I think Eddie touched on it a little bit. He did Quiet Riot for so long, but I don't think people realize how many albums Frankie was on. He told me once that he had recorded between 25 and 30 albums, and I was like, you know, wow, I didn't even realize he had worked that much. He had done so many studio albums for other people, whether they were bands or whether they were individual artists. This guy worked all the time, and he has a catalog of stuff that he's played on, and it's something people should check out, you know. But he did a lot of work, and I just think of the guy all the time, man. There was a bond right from 77 all the way through, and like I said, we didn't hang all the time, not even talk all the time, but we knew we were brothers in arms, and we were fellow drummers that just followed our dreams. And they had a video last night that Regina played at the Rainbow, and it is so true. The video is Frankie talking about his time in 77 at the Rainbow, and he talked about a story about him and us, not me, but us, the whole gang of guys, how we would walk around the room and just eat people's pizza off the table and drink their drinks, and none of us had money. And I gotta tell you, you know, it sounds like it might be a little bit embellished, but it's not at all. I was there, and that really, really happened. And when I was watching that video, it was amazing. It just hit at home, and I thought all the way back to 77 how we were broke and just dreaming, And all of us just kept pushing, and we all got signed, and we all got to do things. And I think of Frankie right now, and I love the guy, and I'll never forget him. He'll be a friend for life. Even though he's gone right now, I'll never forget this guy. Thank you for coming. God bless Frankie.
Thank you, Steve. Steve brings up some great points there, because Steve's saying that he didn't see Frankie all that often, but when he did, it's like, you know, seeing your brother. I could very much relate to that, because again, I'm an East Coast guy, and him being out here, there could be a year or two that would go by, I might not see him, and then again, that big smile, that big hug that you look forward to so much whenever, I know I did, whenever I heard that Quiet Riot or Frankie was going to be a part of anything that I was also on, and that I'd have a chance to see him. Also, when Steve was talking about stuff that he did that maybe people don't know, I know Glenn Hughes is going to be up in a little bit, but that Hughes Thrall album is just unreal. And Money Money, the Billy Idol version of that, Frankie's drums on that, and that's Frankie Banali. So, yeah, the catalog beyond just the Quiet Riot stuff or maybe the Wasp stuff that most people would know is really, really impressive. Okay, next up, we have Todd Trent. Todd is the former artist relations rep at Ludwig, and he is the man who first gave Frankie his first ever Ludwig endorsement. So let's welcome Todd to the stage now.
Good afternoon. You know, when Regina first asked me to do this, I said no. Not because I don't want to honor Frankie, but because I truly didn't believe that I could put into words anything even remotely close to how I feel about the man. I slept on it, agreed to do it, and now I'm humbled to be here. Thank you. For those of you who knew Frankie, you know he was generous, loving, sincere, honest, hardworking, and a badass drummer. To me, he was truly like a brother. When I decided to do this, I started going through all the stories that I have about myself and Frankie. And I came to the conclusion that it's very, very difficult to speak about Frankie and not have it sound like it's about you, because that's what he would do. Everything that you interacted with Frankie with, it always came back to him wanting to do something for you. So this starts in 1995. I'm working for Ludwig Drums as their artist relations manager. And I'm at the NAMM show. For those of you not in the music business, which I don't think there are many out there, the NAMM show is a very large music convention where all the manufacturers and artists get together, consumers, etc. Standing in the booth, and up walks this guy, and he hands me his bio, says, "You're with Artist Relations?" I said, "Yeah." He said, "Great, I'd like you to consider this." And he turned and walked away. Now that was strange for two reasons, in my mind. One, nobody just leaves their package and walks away. They want to tell you about themselves, and they want to talk about themselves. And as he's walking away, I thought, he looks like Frankie Banali. So instead of taking that package and putting it with the stack of them that I was going to take back to the office and look at, I decided to open it. And there it was, Frankie Banali's bio. But by now, he's 50 yards down the aisle. So I go after him, catch up to him, ask him if he'd like to talk. He agreed, came back. I think he was shocked that I wanted to talk to him. So we sat down, and for the first 5 minutes, all he tried to do was talk me out of giving him an endorsement, telling me how the band wasn't as big as they once were, and on and on. And I finally had to stop him, and I said, "Frankie, you have to understand, I came after you because of who you are in the drumming world. That's what we do. We deal with drummers. And your reputation precedes yourself, not just with Quiet Riot, but with everything you've ever done, the quality of your playing, the quality of the person you are." So we talked and talked, came to an agreement, and it was literally the beginning of a true brotherhood. We literally became brothers. And as a couple of people have already said, you would see him often, or sometimes great distances apart, but time didn't matter. You picked up right where you were, and he always made it feel about you. Fast forward to 2017. I'm on tour with Cheap Trick, working in their production staff, and my wife calls me. She says, Frankie reached out to me, and when you get home, he wants to get together for your birthday. This was odd again. Why didn't he call me? She goes, no, it's all set up. He just wanted to reach out and get this done. Now, we live quite a ways apart. He's out in the valley. I'm out, we're out by Palm Springs. So we agree to meet in the middle. And there's a reason for that, which they cooked up. We're sitting at dinner, and he hands me this card, and I open it. It's a nice birthday card, and I'm looking through it, and there's a picture of one of his custom Frankie Banali signature drum sets. I thought, okay. I said, yeah, this is a great kit. And he goes, yeah, I know. It's in the car. It's for you. And he gave me one of his drum sets for my birthday. There are only two of these in the world. And they cooked up this plan to meet in the middle, not because we weren't willing to drive to him, because that's where the lockout was, where my gear was. He drove it to me for my birthday. I was in complete disbelief, and today it is literally one of my prized possessions, and I still can't believe that he did that. And I'm going to bring it to the last time I saw Frankie. 2020, January, at the NAMM show. At the Ludwig booth. I don't work for Ludwig anymore. I'm just there visiting friends. And there's a tap on my shoulder. And I turn around, and it is the last person on earth I would have expected to see here at that event. And there he was, and this giant embrace takes place like it was never going to end. And he was there to show everybody that he was the fighter, that everybody knew he was, that he wasn't giving up, and he was there to see his friends. He was Frankie Banali to the end. I will never, ever be able to tell stories and put the words to justice, but I thank you for listening.
Thank you, Todd. Yeah, last time I saw Frankie was at the NAMM show as well, and I was stunned when he walked in because he was, not doing great at that time. And there he was at NAMM, and there was a band playing, and he got up and played with them, did a couple songs. And, hearing everybody speak, I think of the sense of humor he had right till the end, because I remember seeing him at NAMM, gave me a big hug, we talked, and I said, so what are you doing? I said, you good? You getting better? He goes, well, I'll never forget, he said this to me. He goes, well, I'm not going to be buying any green bananas anytime soon, but I'm hanging in there. And it took me a second to think what he's talking about. And it was just, you can only laugh. He had this way, like, no matter how much you were hurting inside for him, that he just lightened the mood and had an attitude about it. Like, yeah. And then he went up and played. He went up and played a few songs with the band that was there. And it's again, how he handled himself towards the end is just simply remarkable. Okay, so before we get to another speaker, we have another video montage to show, and we'll take a look at that on the screen right now. Regina being a director right to the very end, running around somewhere trying to figure out what's going on with the video. Not sure where she went, actually. Well, while we're sorting this out, I'll fill here with a, it's coming off of that NAMM thing and talking about some of the interviews he did at the very end. I'm very, very proud of the fact that in his final, you know, his final year or so, he very much wanted, and I offered this to him, to be a catalyst to connect with fans and talk to the audience and tell the fans that were concerned about him and his well-being how he was doing and to keep in touch with them. Of course, he could do it through social media, but through the radio as well. And that's where those two interviews where he, you know, while he was sick that we did that were quite extensive. And he hung out in the studio with me for a while. We got into a lot of different things. And then I do recall very vividly that he contacted me about doing a phone interview. And I said, anything specific you want to talk about? And he's, no, just want to come on for a little bit. And I had said to him, I said, you got an open door, pal, anytime. He said, yeah, I just want to come on. And I got to tell you, that was, to me, we never really spoke about it, but to me, it was a signal that he knew that, you know, the end, I think, was near at that point. And really, that conversation was really interesting because it was the last time I had him on the air, and I think it was very much about him saying a thank you and a farewell to fans. I really got this tone that that's what that was about, and that's how much he loved those fans at that point and what he wanted to convey. Okay, I think we've got the video working. Okay, Regina has the sound fixed. So here we go, Frankie on the screen.
About me. He wanted, you know, some background information about me. He says, you're gonna have to hang out with Frankie to see what he's like and make up out of get. I get a phone call one day and it's Kevin. So he asked me if I was doing anything. So he said, okay. In his yellow Opel GT, which is the poor man's Corvette. And so he comes into my apartment and we looked at a bunch of records, and it was great because a lot of the records I had, he had. Music appreciation relationship, which nobody else was listening to. So I get in his car and we're on the way to the Rainbow, and I said, wait. Go past the Rainbow and go to Gil Turner's Liquors. And he said, okay. And so we parked the car and we went in, and I said, do you have any money? And you know,
I think Frankie would probably find this kind of funny, you know, Frankie, actually, don't you think? He seemed like, Regina's going to work on this, see if we can get the audio and video together. So while we're sorting that out in the back, we can try to get that reset and bring that to you in a bit. So we'll bring another speaker up as she works on that for a second. But this is a guy that I mentioned earlier, who I just had a chance to reconnect with through this, and I had not seen in decades. And I know somewhere if I found a Rolodex of mine from being 19 years old, I remember his name and number being in it because he was the tour manager for Quiet Riot when I was starting my career. And we'd like to bring him up right now. Please welcome to the stage John Vazalou, everybody.
A quick Eddie Trunk story. The first time we did an in-store in New Jersey, I think he came through the line about six times and I threw him out. You know, us guys backstage, we're not public speakers, so bear with me. And I am the crier in the family, so I apologize up front. First, I want to thank Regina for giving me this opportunity. I wanted to speak at Kevin's funeral, but my wife held onto my belt and I couldn't stand up. So I got a few things I want to share with you guys. First, I want to acknowledge some people. Is Kevin's mom here, Laura? Is she watching it online?
I want to acknowledge Becky and Rudy. This is the mental health crew. Becky and Rudy, I hear Chuck's on a boat somewhere. I think Ronnie is here. I think we got a couple Missies. Are the Missies here? And I want to thank Mark Hyman. Mark Hyman is the reason I'm standing here today. He's at home in his hospital bed. And I'd like to thank Warren Entner, who gave me the job. I think he's watching this from the 13th hole at Mountain Gate. So in May of 83, I got a job to work for this metal band from L.A. They were driving across country in an RV playing clubs, and I was hired to do the Scorpions tour as the professional. So I sat in a hotel. It was May 23rd, 1983. I was in the hotel, or rather the motel, in Duluth, Minnesota, waiting for the band to show up. And finally a knock came late. I opened the door, and there's these guys in gym shorts, cut-off T-shirts, and sneakers. And I wasn't really used to that, and I thought this was going to be very interesting. I was wearing cowboy boots, boxer shorts, and my latest tour T-shirt, which was Rose Tattoo, and I thought I'd test their humor, and I'd see if I could scare them. They didn't laugh, and they didn't look afraid. Later, Frankie told Warren that I wouldn't last a week, so I didn't find this out until much later, but the guys really rose up for the Scorpions tour. Rudy and Frankie really, 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 like they couldn't hear anything, but they were solid and tight. Carlos made those Marshall stacks ring. Kevin was, I don't think he'd been out of LA County, and he was just so full of joy. I wish that Kevin was here today. He was finally living that hard-earned dream that he had worked so hard on. We were traveling in the RV. I turned on most of the guys to truck stop food. So after a few days, I would hear this little smelly sound and a few giggles. And so I held on and I held on until I was the perfect timing. So I introduced the guys to rock and roll napalm Greek style. And Frankie or Kevin would yell, "Ronnie, pull over, pull over, I can't breathe." And we'd stop on the side of the road and they all fall out laughing. And I knew I had been accepted. From there, we kind of worked clubs, working our way across the country. And we finally got into Long Island on July 2nd. We pull in the parking lot. There's a line around the club. There's a line down the block. And it's 11 a.m. I call Warren Entner, the manager, and I woke him up and I said, "Hey, Warren, I think you got a hit on your hands, and I think I've got a lot of work ahead of me." Frankie was really the leader of the band. Kevin deferred to Frankie. Frankie taught him about stage presence. He taught him about clothes. He taught him about food. He taught him about fine wines. And he did it with really brotherly love. And I don't even think Kevin realized how much control Frankie had over his life. There's a couple Frankie stories that I want to share. This is the yin and yang of Frankie. So during that mental health tour, we did a lot of clubs, a lot of support slots, and every once in a while we'd get an offer to play a show on our own. So we had a chance to play the Mid-South Coliseum in Memphis. And I'm in the box office selling the show, and security walks in and says, "Hey, buddy, your band stopped playing." The box office manager stopped counting the hundreds. The promoter gave me a dirty look, and I said, "I'll be right back." I went out into the hallway, and the local sound company's monitor engineer was running right towards me and almost clipped me, and he was out the front doors, and there was Frankie hot on his heels. And I grabbed Frankie, and I said, "Hey, Frankie, we haven't been paid yet." So Frankie, being the businessman, turned around, headed back to his drum kit, started back up the show. I asked the crew what was going on, and they said the monitors had been ringing the whole show, and Frankie'd had enough, and he finally threw a drumstick at the guy, and the guy made the mistake of throwing the drumstick back. Then Frankie being Frankie, the mic stand on the snare drum is really small. It's like a little bit bigger than a tomahawk. And Frankie picked up that mic stand, threw it at the guy, and came off after him. That was Frankie. That was passionate Frankie to a T. During the height of Beatlemania, the record became number one in November, and it turned into Beatlemania. And for a lot of you in this room, you know how hard it is to get a number one record. They were up against Michael Jackson, they were up against the Police, they were up against Sting. But finally, before Thanksgiving, that record turned number one, and it became Beatlemania. Carlos and Kevin were kind of embarrassed by it. They were a bit amused. Rudy and Frankie embraced it. There were many times I saved them after they had been pinned to the side of the bus because they thought they could just walk through that sea of screaming girls and it would part, but it never parted. One time, poor Frankie, he was pinned under a motorcycle, a cop's motorcycle, with a ton of girls screaming on top of him. But that was our Frankie. He was never afraid. A couple years ago, I had dinner with Frankie and Regina at NAMM. I said, Frankie, how's it going? And he said, you know, for having a shaved head and wearing a diaper, I'm jamming tonight in the bar if you want to come down and see me. That's our Frankie. Before Frankie was diagnosed, I live in Florida. In Florida, Frankie was playing about 45 minutes from my house that February before he was diagnosed. And the night before the show, I went over and sat in the hotel lobby with him, and everything had changed. It was just me and Frankie in the lobby talking. And I really appreciate the fact that we had that chance to bond. And you compare it back to Beatlemania, now Frankie's talking about the love of his life, Regina, about Ashley, how much he loved his daughter, how proud he was of the band, and he was going to do it until he couldn't stop. During the height of Beatlemania, the record company asked us to go to children's hospitals for Make-A-Wish. And that's really hard after you've played a sold-out Coliseum and rode a tour bus all night. Hey guys, before sound check, we're going by the hospital. But they did it with grace. Frankie went the extra mile. We had these little kids there freaked out. I don't think they knew who Quiet Riot was, but we came in and Frankie always was touchy and feely and try to get them to laugh, put a mask on them. The moms would be crying. Frankie would put a big arm around him and say, come on, let me give you an Italian hug, and he'd spin him around the room. The last Frankie story. Frankie told me they didn't want to record Come On, Feel the Noise. He said he played it badly just to make the producer mad. And, you know, even if Frankie's playing bad, it's still good. Thank God Spencer Proffer got his way because it was history after that. They made history after that. My last time I was with Frankie was at NAMM. I had dinner with Regina and Frankie, and I asked him, I said, Frankie, are you at peace with God? And he said, John, I'm at peace with God. When I met Frankie, first time I went down to his hotel room with Rudy to do interviews at 11 a.m., I'm ratting them out. They were reading their Bible and doing sit-ups. Very different from what I was used to. So I know I'll see Frankie again. Life is short. Enjoy the day. Live it passionately like Frankie did. And if you haven't made peace with God, life is short.
Thanks very much, John. Just a note on that video that we were having some trouble with, that will be posted online. Apparently there's an issue with the file, but Regina said she'll put that online for everybody to see soon. But we do have another video that hopefully will work okay coming up in just a few minutes. But right now I'd like to bring to the stage, and I see him back there, so start walking, bud. From Poison, Ricky Rocket is here, and he's going to come up and say a few words. And it's great to see Ricky last night and share some memories and some fun memories about Frankie. And Ricky, Ricky Rocket from Poison, everybody. Welcome him to the stage.
Man, Riley, you nailed it. You're a really good speaker, dude. Has every drummer in this room, like, eyed this gong? You know, yeah, I think so. I'm going to tell two stories about Frankie. One is going to be the first time that we met, and then another time that I think is pertinent to his character. So when Poison toured on our first record, which at the time was an independent record, we got the Quiet Riot gig, opening for Quiet Riot, which was amazing because we were huge fans. We were a band back east, and back there, everything at that time in New York, I think anybody that remembers the early part of the 80s, everything was new wave. On the West Coast, things were turning rock, and Van Halen and Quiet Riot was saving the day. They were literally busting the doors open for rock and roll, for bands like us, or anybody that wanted to play rock and roll. So we went out on the road with Quiet Riot, and at that time, Quiet Riot started, they were going through some changes by that time. And Kevin probably wasn't the happiest guy in the world. He had, and I'll come full circle with this because I'm not talking crap on anybody, I promise. I think he had some demons at the time. And he was wanting to take it out on the new opening band that was starting to come up. So we didn't get a lot of perks on that tour. In fact, it got to the point where we were only allowed in the building 15 minutes before we went on and 15 minutes when we came off. And we weren't allowed to have drinks or food or anything. Basically, just come in the dressing room, go on stage, play, and come out. And I think John Vazelo knows about that. And I think John and I spoke a couple years ago about that. He said, oh, Kevin made me do it. And but every single night, I mean, with no exceptions, Frankie would come to our dressing room, even if he had to walk through the audience with a case of beer in one hand and a case of water in the other hand for us, every single night. And years later then, I don't even remember what year it was, but Poison was touring, we were doing a headlining tour, and Quiet Riot was opening for us. And I'm sitting there going, oh God, I'm really excited that Frankie's gonna be out there. I'm not so excited about Kevin, and Frankie's so good, like I can't even go on after this, right? And I think the first night I saw Kevin, and Kevin said, can I talk to you for a second? I said, yeah, sure. I walked over and we sat for about an hour and a half and talked about everything under the sun and how he apologized for everything that had happened in the past, and he came full circle with his life, and he meant it. And Frankie walks past, and we're talking, and he goes, it's about frickin' time you guys kiss and make up. And we had a great tour, and it was awesome. Frankie and I had always been so, so good with each other. And then, years later, I got asked by Brian Tichy to do the Bonzo Bash, which to me is really a cool thing that he was doing for a while. And so I agreed to it, and I get a call from Frankie. And Frankie says, listen, I know I haven't talked to you in a while. And Brian facilitated the call because I didn't have his number anymore. So he called me up, and he goes, hey, I'm making some Italian food from scratch, and I know that you're vegetarian, and I'm making pasta fazool, and it's got some meat in it, and I want to make you some. What day are you going to be there? Because I want to make sure I have some for you. That's the kind of guy Frankie was. And then 2 years later, I see him at an animal event, and he had gone vegetarian. So everything comes full circle, you know what I'm saying? And it was just really an awesome thing to get to know him over the years. throughout my career. Then I got the call from Frankie and Regina that he was struggling. And some of you may know that I went through stage 4 cancer, and it was throat cancer. I survived it, and I had some novel treatments that saved me, and Frankie wanted to know about it. And I said, absolutely. So I turned him on to my doctors down in San Diego. But it turned out that there really wasn't anything more that they were doing at the time or that was available than what he was doing up here. So we couldn't really facilitate anything different except just to be a shoulder. And I told him, you can call me any time of day or night. It does not matter. I will talk to you. This is, you know, the cornerstone of cancer is fear. And he never acted scared about it. I'm sure he was, but he never showed it. I showed it all the time. I'm like, I'm scared to death, you know? He was just really, he was a tough guy. He was a tough guy. And when he lost that battle, it killed me because I really thought, if anybody can do it, he can do it. But I'll tell you, that one that he had made mine look like kindergarten. That one is a bitch. And it's one that I hope that in the very near future, we really get a hold on. Anyway, thanks for letting me share a couple of funny stories, and I want to say hi to John then later. But thanks for summing it up, Steve Riley. I mean, you were just, that was so good. I appreciate it. And Eddie, thank you. Thank God I got through this without crying. Thank you so much.
You know, hearing Ricky speak and Steve Riley earlier, being guys in bands that were coming up with Quiet Riot, I mean, the one thing that I think is really coming through here, and I touched on it earlier when I started, is the impact and importance of what Frankie and Quiet Riot did early on, because I don't think they get enough credit for the breakthrough that they gave us rock fans, that putting rock front and center, a number one record. I remember Quiet Riot headlining Madison Square Garden on that record. It was so impactful as a young kid, for me starting in the business, or for these guys being in musicians themselves. It was inspirational to see that a band could play heavy rock and have that kind of success, a number one record, and all of a sudden playing in arenas. Of course, to many, it seemed like an overnight success, but there was a history before that, especially here in LA, that people local certainly know about. But to the world, it seemed like this amazing overnight success, and it opened so many doors for so many people, not only people in bands, but as I said earlier, for myself as well, because it was one of the things that I used to convince my local radio station to let me on the radio. So really, really heavy stuff when you think about it. All right, so I mentioned earlier, and a few times it's come up, that Frankie played on a lot of other records outside of Quiet Riot, and of course some Wasp records that he's credited on. And for the longest time, I didn't know this was Frankie on this record, but you know, my dear friend Glenn Hughes did a great record called Hughes Thrall many decades ago. And I remember speaking to Glenn once about it, because if you have that record, the photo on that record is just two guys. It's Pat Thrall and Glenn. So I never really knew who this was before I got really geeky and totally into who played on every record, but I never really knew who the drummer was. I remember talking to Glenn about it once. He goes, that's Frankie. I said, Frankie. And you hear it and it's like, wow, it makes all the sense in the world. So I'd like to welcome to the stage a man that has a long history with Quiet Riot and, of course, with Frankie as well. Please welcome, he's known as the voice of rock, and he still is in my book, Glenn Hughes, everybody.
It was 40 years ago this month that I started to make this album with Pat Thrall in Hollywood. And we'd been playing with numerous guys from in town and out of town. And then a friend of a friend mentioned a fellow from New York that was living in Hollywood who was a John Bonham fanatic. I said, bring him down. With his green sparkle Ludwig kit. I fell in love with that kit, and I fell in love with him. He was fanatical about Led Zeppelin, as we all are. But what sold it for me, we had two songs we were working on, one called Don't You Hesitate in demo form, and another song called Hold Out Your Life, which actually made the album. With the one song, Don't You Hesitate, it was very, very heavy and groovy, which Frankie was played wonderfully. But what really struck me was when we hadn't really written the arrangement of the drum part for the next song called Hold Out Your Life, and it was reggae influenced, I didn't realize that Frankie was at all interested in reggae. I wasn't either, but Pat Thrall was. So we started jamming on this tune, and I was blown away that Frankie could actually play reggae at all. That was the thing that sold it for me, for him to get into the band. And we'd played with 30 guys, all brilliant, but something about Frankie, something about his persona, he was always there on time. If you knew Frankie, he was always the first there and last to leave, which was remarkable. But the essence of who he was when I met him, he's an only child like myself, which was great. We loved our mothers. You know, if you knew Frankie, he loved his mother, and I certainly loved mine. His personality was something I had not had in a long time. We spent a lot of time together at his very small apartment in Hollywood. I didn't drink so much when I was with Frankie. I respected the fact that he was working with this new... I didn't want him to see that I could be a jackass. Well, he saw it for sure, but we didn't get a lot of drinking going on. We just really wanted to play music. As you remember, Quiet Riot were about to start making Metal Health, so we had to be quick in making this album with Pat Thrall, with Frankie, called Hughes Thrall. He got to play on a song that I'd written in my band Trapeze called Coast to Coast. I think he liked Trapeze because Bonzo loved Trapeze, and Frankie followed Bonzo, so anything that John Bonham loved, Frankie loved. So we went about re-recording my song called Coast to Coast, which Frankie played brilliantly. Frankie, in my opinion, of his peer group, was one of the top three drummers in town in that period, in the early 80s, and I was very privileged to play with him. And Quiet Riot were very lucky to have him on that album, and Rudy and Carlos and my dear friend Kevin, who I'm going to speak about very shortly. When they had the hit with Metal Health, huge album, big pop rock album. I was a friend, Judas Priest, a good friend of mine. I was down at Long Beach at a Judas Priest show, and I first met Kevin in 1984. And I called Frankie the next day to tell him I'd met this rambunctious, dazzling, excitable singer, your singer Kevin. He was so full of life. He was so full of it and full of life that I couldn't help but fall in love with him. Throughout the years, I had met Frankie on and off around town. We called each other. Frankie, it's very easy for me to say this, and I'm sure most of us knew Frankie very well. So we all know how family orientated he was. And for me, anything that ever happened in my life, good, bad, weird, ugly, indifferent, he was the first to show up, call, quiz, ask, tell, rant. He was the first one on board. He certainly was the first one on board when I got out of Betty Ford Center in February of 1992. God knows how he found me. I'd moved from Old Holland, and I'd moved to the South Bay. And God knows how he found me, but he found me to wish me all the very best on my new journey of sobriety. A whole new world for me. And throughout my years of sobriety, I kept in touch with Frankie. And in the early 2000s, Frankie called me to tell me that Kevin was going to come and see me perform in Las Vegas with a band I was kind of working with back 19 years ago. And Frankie mentioned Kevin was going to come before the show and meet me. And I was actually happy about that. I'd been sober quite a long time. And Kevin came back to see me, and he was so happy to see me. And we fell in love with each other right off the get-go. It was such a wonderful experience. He was rambling on about my voice and rambling on about how do I do this and how do I do that. I said, I don't know. I just show up, you know. And from that moment, in 2002, Kevin and I and Frankie became once again the three amigos. Trust me, I've had a three amigo moment many times in my life. But with Kevin and Frankie, this was the three amigos I'd been searching for, in sobriety for sure. Now, Frankie was now on the outside. Kevin and I were in the... Kevin got a place... We live in the South Bay a long time, and Kevin has got his own room at my house. Gabby set a room up for Kevin. Kevin came to stay with me and Gabby on numerous occasions. And again, due to my sobriety, I never saw Kevin take a drink. From 2002 until the end, never saw him take a drink. You know, I never. But I knew he'd leave my house and go home to Vegas and maybe he'd take a cocktail. We never spoke about that. I never quizzed Kevin. And Frankie would call me, how did it go last night? How did it go? I said, it was great. Everything was fantastic. Well, he never showed up tonight somewhere in America. Kevin never made the plane. I never saw that side of Kevin, but Frankie was always questioning me. How was he? Is he okay? Again, Frankie again was very much involved in this trio of personalities. Frankie was, although I'm a little bit teeny older than Frankie, he was the big brother for me. He certainly was a big brother to all of us in this room, I believe. And the reason I'm speaking about Kevin right now is because the depth of love that Frankie has, we all know Kevin and Frankie were inseparable. Even when they weren't working together and not talking to each other, they were inseparable. And you know, I must, if I can, talk about... Gabby threw a party for me November 23rd, 2007. It was a Friday night, and on the Monday morning previous, Kevin was talking to Gabby about what he was going to wear with his new red jacket to my party. What scarf, what color scarf am I going to wear? I don't know. You're going to wear it, it's going to look great. So in between Monday and Friday, I couldn't get a hold of Kevin. Frankie and I were concerned. I'll make this short because let's get back to Frankie. Frankie was at my party and we were wondering where Kevin was. Nobody could find him. Two days later, we all got the call. Well, I got the call. The hardest thing I ever had to do in my whole life was call Frankie, you know. The depth of love on the other end of the phone, somebody had to make that call. What can I say? It was, I can't describe in words the feeling. Again, the pain and the joy and the love and the acceptance of death. We have to accept death. It's going to come to all of us. We have to embrace it and live it and breathe it and accept it. When he lost his mother, it was difficult to console him. And when we lost Kevin, as Ashley said to me last night, that's the only time she saw her father cry. To be part of that scenario, the trio of Kevin and Frankie and Glenn, the bond was even stronger from that point. Kevin very much is alive, living within me, and Frankie is absolutely the same way. So I'm honoring Frankie Banali today, as I do every day that I live and breathe. I did spend numerous occasions at Frankie's home with Regina and Ashley towards the end. I regret not seeing Frankie play the Whiskey, his last show here in October of 2019. I was on my way to Paris to make an album. It's not a day goes by that I do not think of Frankie and pray for him. I know he's with his mom and dad. I know he's with, you know, his people. You know, I know he's home. He wasn't afraid to die. He just didn't want to leave. Nobody wants to leave, you know. So I stand here in front of you, honoring this wonderful, wonderful human being. And may he live in our hearts forever. Thank you kindly for being here.
Glenn Hughes, everybody. Okay, so we have another video presentation and a few more speakers before we wrap up. Hopefully the video will cooperate this time around, so I direct your attention to the screen.
After Kevin died, I had a dream one night that I was like laying on this floor, it was a wooden floor, on my side, facing a door. And I looked around the room, and the room was all white, you know, windows and light was washing into the room. And I hear a knock on the door. And so I look, and there was a gap underneath the door, and I see Kevin's snakeskin boots. And then all of a sudden I hear in Kevin's voice, "Frankie, come on, let's go. Come on, let's go, Frankie." And I was like paralyzed for whatever reason. I couldn't move, I couldn't talk. And he kept knocking on the door. "Come on, Frankie, we gotta go. Come on, let's go, we gotta go." And then it stopped. And then he says, "Okay, I see you're not ready to go yet. I'll come back for you." And I saw the feet go away. Well, weirdest fucking dream ever.
Hello you, yes it's me, you can come back, you're flying free, you think you've found everything that you need. Fly away. And I can't help but think that someday you'll be back home. Whoa.
Before I was diagnosed, man, I'm strong as a fucking bull.
We love you!
Now I'm strong as two fucking bulls, so. So I plan to entertain you with my loud drumming for some time to come, all right?
Which is fantastic. You know, one of the storylines in that documentary is Frankie being conflicted with whether he should keep Quiet Riot going with Kevin being gone, and should there be a future, should he do the band again? And one of the people who has been instrumental in keeping the band going and playing in Quiet Riot since 2004 and still to this day is guitarist Alex Grossi. So let's welcome him to the stage right now.
When I was a kid growing up watching MTV, it became very clear to me that I wanted to be a rock star, as a lot of us did, and many kids do. And I soon started to look at these guys and bands on MTV and whatnot as my heroes. Well, as time went on and I ended up eventually moving out here to California, I found myself playing with some of these actual guys that I had considered heroes and, you know, had posters of on my wall just maybe a decade earlier. And at that point, the term hero suddenly kind of lost a little bit of its luster, to say the least, by actually seeing what was behind the curtain, if you will. That was until I met Frankie. When I joined Quiet Riot, Frankie showed me that with the right discipline and focus, you can be a lot more than just a guy on stage playing an instrument and pretending to be a rock star. You can be, you know, you can wear many hats, you know, like Frankie did in Quiet Riot. He wore a lot of different hats. He did a lot more behind the scenes, and he did it all very well. And there really isn't a day that goes by that I don't use the knowledge and some of the skills that he taught me, you know, pretty much every day. And these aren't skills that apply to the band or the music business. These pretty much apply to life. And, you know, I'm very grateful for all, for everything that I've learned from him through that. And I know I'm not the only one. I've seen countless others in the industry and outside the industry that he's affected in the same way. I distinctly remember one time meeting Chris Holmes from Wasp, and he told me that the one person that he would work with, he would love to work with again from his past, would be Frankie Banali, and how lucky I was to be in a band with him. And it really, you know, made me think. I was like, wow, this is, he was genuinely sincere. I don't know what it was, but Frankie had affected him in a way and had an impact on him throughout his journey that was that memorable, where it, that so many people maybe didn't. And, you know, it definitely hit home with me, and I'm sure there's a lot of people in this room that can identify with that. Frankie always saw the good in people that genuinely had good in them. And if he liked you, he'd love you, you know, do anything for you. He was probably the most honest, brutally honest, straightforward, and probably the most loyal person I've ever met, which, as many of you know, is very hard to find in the music business. As the Hunter S. Thompson quote goes, the music business is a cruel and shallow money trench, a long plastic hallway where thieves and pimps run free and good men die like dogs. There's also a negative side. Well, I can say without reservation that Frankie Banali solely proved to me that there are exceptions to this quote. And for that, I'm forever grateful. I could not have asked for a better mentor, friend, role model, and even father figure over the years. So, Frankie, we miss you, and thank you for giving me a new type of hero to look up to.
Our next speaker is a man that extraordinarily talented, wonderful, wonderful person who has been in many, many bands in his incredible career. But I think for most of us, myself included, the band you always think of him in is Quiet Riot. And he's back in Quiet Riot again, ladies and gentlemen. Please welcome to the stage Frankie's best friend since 1972, Rudy Sarzo.
Okay, boy, I thought this was going to be easier, but it's not. Okay, so what I'm going to do is I'm going to celebrate Frankie's life, and I'm going to connect with funny, happy memories of him, because I want to be able to do this. Okay, so 1972, November 17, 1972. I go to a show at Pirates World. This is in Dania, Florida, right outside Fort Lauderdale. And I walk in, and there is a last-minute replacement band performing. I have no idea who they are. And the headliner was David Bowie with Ziggy Stardust. Knew that, and the Spiders from Mars tour that he was doing in 1972. So I walk in, and I'm watching the band, and I'm going, God, these guys are really good, but that drummer, he's just amazing. So I kept raving about him to my friends at the that were with me. And anyways, Bowie comes on, and you know, it was David Bowie, glam, but it didn't have the power that I was getting from the first band, and it definitely didn't have the drummer. That was just magnificent. So the next day, on my birthday, November 18th, I go to a place called the Flying Machine, which was like the rainbow button for Lauderdale. Okay, so all the rock musicians were hanging out there, and I'm talking to some friends, and somebody goes, oh, that's one of the guys from the band that opened up for Bowie last night. So I go over immediately,
and start raving about the band, especially the drummer, how great he was. So all the while, this person that I'm talking to is smiling and then lets me talk, keep raving about the drummer, and then he smiles and goes, "Hi, I'm Frankie." And he shakes my hand. "I'm the drummer and Ginger." And I go, "Okay." And that minute started a friendship that lasted all these years. A friendship and a partnership, a family. Family was very important to Frankie. You know, he was actually the first musician outside of my own family with my brother that I actually felt a brotherhood. When we started playing together, I would go over to his house, and he had a massive collection of vinyl records. He used to work at a record store, and he would collect all these rare imports, stuff, you know, bands that I wasn't even aware that existed. And he would show me these different musical styles, fusion, rock, and all of that, that I wasn't even aware of. And we started playing locally, and then disco came in. And I mean, you know, Frankie was tenacious and resourceful. So in order for him to play, even outside of the bands that we had, he would play in a disco band, funk band, playing mostly James Brown music, which he loved. James Brown, he loved Miles Davis, he loved so many different musical styles outside of rock and metal, you know, which made him a very complete musician. And Frankie would show up to this disco gig wearing an Afro wig that he had, just to fit in, you know, be part of that brotherhood, you know, of that band, you know. So eventually, we decide, Frankie and I, that we have to get out of Florida if we were going to make it in the music business. And I go up to Chicago, and I have a band up there, and when we needed a drummer, I called Frankie up, and he moved up to Chicago, and we started playing, and that band fell apart. And we decided, okay, let's go to L.A. Now, this is 1977. And immediately, as soon as we get to L.A., we go to the Rainbow. We're at the Rainbow parking lot. And we're meeting all these musicians. And we met this young lady. She was very young, a singer. And she was a good singer. But most important, she had a friend who she could borrow her friends who was pregnant, her urine, so she could get welfare to pay for our apartment, you know. And so, yes, we had a band now, and we had an apartment, and we were sharing this apartment. And again, Frankie being very resourceful, I'm sure many of you have tasted his magnificent culinary arts. But the first time I tasted Frankie's first dish, was actually, okay, this is how broke we were. We used to not steal, but take some pepper or syrup from these places that we could never afford to eat, but we could go in there and maybe order coffee and then take all the condiments, take them back. And in the mornings, Frankie would make, because we could always afford flour. Because back in the day, 1977, there were pay phones, and sometimes there was like leftover coins, and we'd collect that, right? At night, we would buy box wine at the Mayfair, right on Santa Monica and Kings Road, which by the time we drank the box wine for about $1, we had a buzz once we got to the Rainbow. So whatever was left over, we used that for groceries, which meaning one bag of flour. That was it. So with flour and water, Frankie would make these. In the morning, there would be crepes, call it fake crepes, right? And we would put the syrup that we borrowed from these places and make, that was our breakfast. Then in the evening, take the flour again with water and make fake burritos, or just actually pepper just pepper, and this, it's like stucco paste, you know. But it was somehow, it tasted great, you know. And if everybody wondered, how come old rock musicians were so skinny back then? That's why, one of the many reasons why. Also because that way we could fit into like girls' clothes. Like, you know, after the rainbow, you know, you go and visit some girl's closet, and that's your new stage outfit, basically, you know, right there. And eventually the longest pregnancy in history had to end, and we lost the apartment, and I went to New Jersey to play with my brother and make, you know, gather some money together. Frankie stayed in LA. He was in multiple bands, you know, and eventually I came back in 1978 and joined Quiet Riot, which led me, you know, the Randy Rhoads version of Quiet Riot, and led me, when Randy joined Ozzy, shortly after that, he recommended me to play in with Ozzy. Then in 1982, Randy passes away, and see, Quiet Riot was always a family also. It had a collective consciousness that we all felt, that brotherhood. Frankie was my family before that. Then Quiet Riot was my family. And playing with Ozzy, having lost Randy, I lost the joy of playing. I lost my family, you know? So I get a phone call from Kevin Dubrow, Kevin, who I had actually played with him in his band Dubrow after Quiet Riot. And there was one song called Thunderbird that I used to play with him during that time. And then after Randy passed away, Kevin called me up and said, hey, listen, we're working on a possible record, and can you come down and record Thunderbird as a tribute to Randy, which he had written when Randy left the band. And then he kind of like retooled it a little bit after Randy passed away to fit more about the true meaning of that song. And so I walk into Pasha Studios, and there's Frankie, almost 10 years to the day that I met him. And there's Frankie there, who we have been in contact all this time. And there's Kevin. And there's my family again. You know, so I was still a member of Ozzy, so like a week later, yeah, you know, after that session, recording Thunderbird and some other songs that wound up on the Mental Health record, I recorded one live record, Speak of the Devil with Ozzy, but I have found my family again. I have found my joy of playing. So as soon as I did my commitment, returned to LA, and gave notice to the Ozzy camp that I was going to rejoin Quiet Riot. It became officially known as Quiet Riot then. And I went from being one of the biggest bands in the world to the complete unknown. I mean, nobody really knew. I mean, we had faith that we were going to sell maybe 50,000 records. But the fact that I found my family again. Thank you.
Thank you, Rudy. Just a couple more speakers, and then we're going to begin to wrap up. And again, we're going to allow everybody to come by and pay their respects to the drum kit, and Frankie's ashes are here as well. And then we'll gather outside and be able to walk and show everybody where Frankie's final resting place will be. But I'd like to welcome to the stage right now Frankie's daughter, Ashley.
First of all, I'd like to thank you, everybody, for coming to celebrate my dad's life. I couldn't help but to feel an overwhelming sense of gratitude and happiness from seeing all the support and all the people, friends, fans, and family that my dad had in his battle with cancer. Mostly because he's so deserving of it. He's always been the type of person to take care of everyone else before himself, no questions asked. He's the type of person that will help you out, and even if you try to give it back to him, he will somehow slip it right back to you without you even noticing. He's always been like that, humble in every sense of the word. For him to receive such tremendous support and love makes my heart so happy. Sorry. His outlook during that time was nothing short of amazing. He brings a whole new word to the meaning strength in my eyes. I'm in awe of the man I got to call my father. Thank you to everyone who continues to pray for him. I cannot thank everyone enough. He truly gave cancer everything he had. He fought with conviction to the very end. To say he is my hero is an understatement. I truly feel honored and blessed to have been able to call him my father. If you knew him, you knew that there is and never will be anyone quite like him. Never. The way he navigated life was truly inspiring. The world lost a beautiful soul, but he leaves behind a beautifully inspirational story. There are not enough words to write just how special he was to me and so many others. Sorry. I'm just happy to know that you are with Kevin now. Beating the drums up there like they owe you money. I wanted to say thank you to Regina for everything that you did for him. I guess I just wanted to tell him that I love him more than life itself. And like he would say, peaceful journey. Thank you.
So our final speaker is another woman who, of course, is Frankie loved as well beyond belief, and who stood by Frankie through so much and, of course, made the Quiet Riot documentary. And when you think about how difficult this all is on everybody, especially Frankie's family, you could imagine how difficult it was navigating Frankie's illness and even trying to do this at the height of COVID. Obviously, this gathering should have happened a long time ago, but wasn't able to because of COVID. So Frankie's illness, all of that, navigating all of this, truly remarkable how she handled it all. And our final speaker, Please welcome to the stage Frankie's wife, Regina.
Hi, sorry, she got me going back there, so I don't know if I'm gonna make it through this. Oh, God. Sorry about the video. I'm actually gonna post that video online. It was the video that we played at the Rainbow last night where he talked about his history with the Rainbow. And as most of you probably know, we unveiled a bronze statue that's on permanent display now at the Rainbow. And I hope that you guys will go see it. So the thing that I can say that no one else here can is what a great husband. Sorry, I did not want to do this. What a he was the best husband in the world. And if you know the five love languages, words of affirmation, gifts, acts of service, quality time, and physical touch, he operated on all of those. But his main love language is acts of service. And trying to think of a story or something to talk about in our 11 years, it was so hard because it was all the little things day by day that happened that I couldn't really figure out what to talk about or zero in on. And it's just like every day, I never made my own cup of tea, it just appeared. He was always doing something for me and supportive of me and loved me more than anyone ever has or will. And that's how he was with everyone. If you were somebody he knew, acts of service was his love language. Can I get a show of hands of anyone who's ever eaten anything that he's prepared? Okay, anyone that he's ever spent time with to sign something or to do, anyone that he's ever helped with something? Okay, so you've all been loved by Frankie Banali because that was his love language. It's important to me going forward now to protect his legacy and his life's work and the people and the band and the animals that he loved, and I will carry on with that, keeping his memory alive. And I ask of you to pay his love language forward with acts of kindness to animals and people and the earth, the planet, in any way, shape, or form you can. The charities that really helped us during our cancer battle were the Ronnie James Dio Stand Up and Shout Fund, so I would love it if you would show them a little love and help. Music Cares, Pan Can, and also one of our favorites, Fix Nation, who has helped us rescue animals. So if you guys wouldn't mind giving them a little love. And to show your love for Frankie, go to the Rainbow and toast his statue. Toast your drink to his statue. And his rock niche is right outside. He wanted to actually pick this church so that everyone could walk right over to the rock niche that he chose. So we'll do that. And he's going to be interned there with his mom. And I will be there someday. So stop by once in a while and see his rock and put a flower on it. So the deers can eat it. He would really love that. So thank you all for coming, and I appreciate you.
Regina mentioned a few cancer funds that helped out, and her mentioning the Ronnie James Dio Cancer Fund, something very near and dear to my heart, because The last time I had the honor to do something like this was for Ronnie right here at Forest Lawn over 10 years ago. And ever since, I've had a chance to work with the DO Cancer Fund and the fundraising events that they do. And it's incredibly important and helpful to so many people who are in that battle. And if you can help any of those causes that she mentioned, it's so so helpful to these folks that are going through all this. You know, there's been a lot of amazing stories and memories here, and I find that when stuff like this happens, you know, it's kind of cliche. People say, oh, you know, we'll remember that person forever, or they'll live forever, or what have you. And, you know, honestly, sometimes it's just human nature that you kind of move on and you don't take that beat to always stop and remember these people that touched us so much. But in the case of Frankie, for all of us that have known him, we know that it's somebody that we'll never forget because of his kindness, because of his generosity, because of the way he connected with all of us, whether it was the people fortunate enough to see him and know him every day, or whether it was someone like me who maybe got to see him once a year. That bond is always there. And even from purely a fan standpoint, maybe fans watching this is streaming right now, there's nobody that's going to ever forget Frankie, or Quiet Riot for that matter, because it is true. When you're a musician who made an impact like that, the music literally lives forever. We're all going to be gone, and some football stadium's still going to be playing Come On, Feel the Noise. There's no doubt about that. You're still going to hear those drums, and you're going to know that that was Quiet Riot, and that was Frankie leading the charge there on that track. So again, Regina, thank you so much for the honor of allowing me to do this, and thank you to everybody who has attended. Thank you to those who are watching on the stream, and we are going to wrap up by encouraging everybody to come up and say a final goodbye to Frankie here. His urn is here. These are his drums. Regina said it's totally cool if you do want to take a photo in front of it as well. And then when everybody has a chance to do that, we'll meet out front and we'll all take a walk over to where Frankie's final resting place will be. Thank you, everybody, for coming.
Daylight is good at arriving. not over.